Thank you all for carving out some time for attending the second episode of BX Academy, Business Excellence, Mentoring and Coaching. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonali, and welcome, friends. Welcome to another edition with the Business X Academy. This is a new series we've started after finishing one full series of 30 episodes under Business X. Business X is part of Franchise India Group, a separate company which works with a lot of startups, early stage companies in helping them to raise funding. Also works with a lot of businesses which want to now sell their businesses. We work on their valuation and finding them the right exit. And also worked on a lot of mentorship and coaching for business owners. So this is a series which is designed to really address a large part of Franchise India's community is what I call small and mid-sized businesses and also a lot of startups. So we talk about every time a particular topic. We are covering this series of business excellence and we talk about different aspects in every time. So today's topic is leadership. So leadership is very important in these days because this is a very unique times and challenging times, or I would call it changing times. From a business, it's completely changing times. What is happening around us is also extremely difficult. And in these times, how business owners are going to really lead from the front and what were leadership qualities they would need to bring in to demonstrate to their ecosystem, their teams, their organization, their vendors, their suppliers, their consumers, and so forth. So we want to talk about the overall leadership and how it is going to change. One of the areas which I would put up a starting point when we talk about leadership, and especially when it comes to challenging times, it's in the adversity, normally you will get to find your natural strengths. You know, this is very important because I have seen so many businesses in the last 14 odd months, because nature of our business is to really consult companies. I found that most of them started discovering their natural strength. When you everything is going well, everything is structured, you start forgetting about your natural strengths. And it's also because this is a time which exposes all your weaknesses. If you have multiple weaknesses in business, when everything is going well, so that also is hidden. It doesn't come out. So this is a very unique time where both really highlight your natural strengths and your weaknesses. And this is now up to you that how do you really maximize your natural strengths. And it is also a greater... so to say, an opportunity, because in the greater the difficulty is, the more the glory is surrounding you. You know, this is something which even our political leaders to understand. You know, we are in a great difficulty, and anybody who really comes out of that, even can be a state leader or it can be even our honorable prime minister, anybody really stands by it and really comes out of it would get even more greater glory. While this time would look like everybody pulling down, but if you right leadership seasons at this stage, it would change. And this is exactly what is true with business owners also. Business owners also have to really understand that in the most difficult times, if they are able to demonstrate their leadership, they would get a much bigger glory, a much better success, which comes in. Also, it is very important that this is a time where a lot of people ask me that as a leader, you should take a risk at this times or not take it. I would say take a risk. It's very important because there are only two ways. One, you have very little to lose now. A lot of, especially smaller businesses are under challenge. A lot of businesses are stuck. And also you don't have too many options, right? So you need to take a little bit of risk, but it's a conscious risk which you need to do. A lot of people are actually withdrawing. That's not good. You need to not need to withdraw. Rather, it should be some sense of urgency for you to keep moving, you know, because otherwise the business would not work. So let's understand what are we going to talk today? First, let's talk about the significance of these changing times, right? If the significance of these changing times and what leadership should be doing, you know, what leadership or leaders should do or business, every business owner is a leader of his company and how he needs to really work on that. So I call the three C's of a leader, you know, very importantly. One is the character, and it can also be as an organization, you know, as a company, how do you really demonstrate yourself out there? What do you stand for? What is the character of the individual or the organization which is representing? The second C is the competence. This is exactly the time where you need to demonstrate absolute competence, what you stand for. This is very important because, you know, if you were doing so many things, leave all that and focus on the most competent area which you have and clearly stand by that. And the third C is, how do you communicate? How do you communicate to the world out there? So these three C's are extremely important for any leader to really follow at this moment. So think about how do you really demonstrate the character? How do you work on your competence and continue to work on that and stay focused on that? And third is, how do you communicate with everybody? Now, the second point is actually about how leaders should put the focus at this moment. You know, so focus is very, very important. And this has changed from what used to be earlier. The focus for leaders was clearly about speed and flexibility. And now it has moved to being agile and resilient. And agile and resilient because the times are very different. You know, you cannot bring predictability in actually every 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 1 month, things change. In March, people were planning very different. Like my organization was planning a lot of physical events because we started booking venues again and April happened, right? So how do you really change the organization because you have now built entire capabilities to do that physical events and a lot of events were planned actually starting May. We had a major event coming in Bombay and we have to change everything, right? So how do you become so agile and resilient? That would be very important. So another vision, you know, so as being showing resilience, you need to set a few things, you know, and first is vision. And vision has become, rather than very long-term, it's become very, you know, very focused, but very short-sighted. You know, it has to be like that because you cannot really set, while you keep the eye on the longer part of it, but you need to be also very clear about these smaller patches, which you need to also achieve. So very clearly, how do you define your purpose and goals within this period? It's very important. And how's your overall composure of the organization? What, how the company is in control with this, is emotions, it's behavior, everything is very, very important. And this time it's actually being more in calm rather than just reflecting on everything. There would be times to reflect, but you cannot reflect on everything right now. I know there is a very different perspective. I know when people, we run a magazine. So earlier when we say magazine was not reached to person or delayed, they would send a different perspective. But now I know frustrations have gone here. So the expectation of a customer, if he's not got something which is expecting to do that, he's not going to take it. He's going to give you very strongly back. And so this is a time where you need to, as an organization, be very calm and to understand where people are coming from because they might have different kind of emotions running with them. Another thing which is very important as a leader is to really follow reasoning. You know, why are we doing this? What problem are we trying to solve? You know, and so you are able to really anticipate and plan better. Sometimes leaders don't able to do that because they're not really putting a reasoning to everything. And they're just trying to do the way they were doing things, and it might not work. It might not work because the world has changed or the way people consume is very different. Another way, business leaders, they were only about running, or business owners were all about putting themselves more hours and so on and so forth. It no more. I mean, I think at this stage, your own well-being is very, very important for your health of your organization. So one of the big focuses, especially small businesses and startups and early stage businesses, they are in the madness of really building their enterprises and so on and so forth. It's very important at this stage, they also think about their own personal health. Persistence would continue to be a very important aspect because you need to be persistent even more now because whatever used to take X effort, now it probably going to take 2X effort. So you need to be more persistent and then only be very important. And then another area which is very important is that you need to be having a very realistic optimism. Optimism is very important, but you need to be realistic about that. You need to be very, very realistic. You don't feel that this is what something which you can achieve. And finally is collaboration. This is environment. You need to collaborate a lot rather than depending all on yourself. So this would be a mix of what I call at this stage, you know, emotional and logical intelligence. How do you really bring the balance of both? How do you really bring your emotional intelligence and also your logical intelligence of another area which is very important for leadership and very difficult at this moment is delegation. How do you delegate to somebody else. You know, it's very, very important also, because if you, it is only dependent on you, it can have a severe issues, because say if you are not available, your health is not good, or something has happened, how your business is going to suffer, right? But delegation is also becoming even more difficult, right? And why delegation is so important for leaders and why they don't do it, let's talk about it. So, you know, so delegation is important for even smaller business owners. You know, so a lot of small business owners don't do it because they feel that everything they would like to do it, or they continue to do it. And they put more hours than their teams because pretty much everything goes back to them. And if you go and closely notice that 60% of tasks any business owner or a leadership is doing is repetitive, and which has a very similar outcome also. So 60% of your task you do in the day is very repetitive and also has a very similar outcome. So you already know the outcome, what is going to happen. Now this 60% task can easily be delegated. So you can really open up your calendar a little bit. So you open up the space so you can get into more important things rather than doing urgent things. So very importantly, think through what are the 60% of the task which you continue to just repeat, which can be done by somebody else with a little bit of training and structure. But still, a lot of people don't delegate. Why they don't delegate? Many reasons. First, they don't trust somebody can deliver a great job. You know, so the trust deficit is there. You don't trust somebody who can really take care of the responsibility. Second, they feel they can do better, right? Most of the business owners have this, feeling that they are the best to do it, you know? So even sometimes you would have to send some kind of proposal. You will say, oh, leave it on me, I'll send it myself, because you feel that you will do a greater job. And third is sometimes, like this is my problem. The third one is that you enjoy doing yourself, right? So you want to be really involved, and because this is something which you like and enjoy. For me, a lot of times talking to clients or structure, I would like to really rather insist my team that I have to be part of the meeting because I enjoy doing it. But sometimes it's not really about that I don't trust them, but it's more about I enjoy that. But still, one has to really find, if you continue to do what you're doing, you'll never get time to do and think on more important things in your business. So how do you really delegate? Another problem with delegation is that sometimes when you delegate, and when the outcome comes, you start comparing, is not as good as what you expected, because you have, and then you start doubting the capability. You need to really do differently. You need to really rather tell people that they are more skilled than you are, they have more energy than you are, and they will probably be able to do a better job than you are. So then only start coming through it. It is a difficult process, especially for mid-sized companies, very, very difficult process to delegate. But unless and until they take these steps, they will not be able to build future leaders or future business owners within their organization who can take and run that structure. Then also there are multiple functions which a leadership has to do. You know, so the leader has to take many, many roles do that. And there are different types of leaders. You know, there are very autocratic leaders who are very instruction based. Which sometimes works in these times, right? A lot of times it's actually, if you really read leadership, autocratic leadership is not something which a lot of people talk about it. It's very one-man decisions and pushing the course. Everybody is talking about more democratic way of doing it. Take your team in confidence and see this entire thing. But sometimes in difficult times, actually, this works more, you know, because the decision have to be done right now. You are getting into a lockdown. You need to make decisions right now. What do you want to do? How do you want to really address the business for next 15 days? So it's fine. This is good. This is very, you know, long-term democratic way of doing it, taking your team in confidence and building that. But I would say in these times, good leaders, while they have to put some kind of intelligence and thinking through and some feedback taking, but they need to also be instruction-based. They need to go out and instruct and say, let's do it this way. And there might be some mistakes happening. You know, if you really ask me, a lot of people said, I'm comparing this for the decision which Mr. Modi did on the first lockdown, when he went out and said lockdown. A lot of people criticized, this was not timing, this was not wrong, this was right. But if you look at from a today's perspective, that probably would have been a better great decision, if I would say from perspective, because that time to bring country in control, better services being available and things like that. And I think anything which would delayed this course has actually erupted. So sometimes some people are very definite about taking decisions. Sometimes the decisions don't look at that moment right. But when you go and revisit history, then it all looks great, decisions of those times. So sometimes you need to have that autocratic structure. If you get into too democratic way of doing it, which we are trying to do now, that everybody has a voice, but nobody is taking decisions. You know, everybody is trying to put on everybody. And that's where things start getting worse. So you need to really be at this stage. I would say that every state head and every our honorable prime minister, everybody has to become a little more stronger leader and take decisive steps rather than a very democratic way of doing it. So you cannot please everybody at this moment. You need to really be, and this is what is happening in our businesses also. That's my own viewpoint, but might be different for other people. So, but I feel that the three functions which a good leader should always really have is what I call the three I. Three I's are very important. One, he has to take the initiative. Nobody else is going to take the initiative for him. You need to take the initiative. He also have to be a great interpreter of things which are happening around. So you can interpret why this was done and what result it created. Third is that he builds the intelligence, a collective intelligence in the business. So if you have these three I's as a leader, to me, that's the most important part of it. There is so much been written on leadership and so much confusing things about leadership and so many skills and functions which are liberal. But I feel that these three I's are the most important aspect for a good leader. Now, let's talk about some of the skills which every leader would need to have. One is at this stage, I would say the first and foremost quality at this stage for any leader to have is adaptability. Adaptability is extremely, extremely important at this moment because everything changes very, very fast and will continue to do that. It's not talking about the current circumstances, but I'm also talking about the business at general and things. And even if you come outside this whole crisis, the businesses are changing faster than we know. So how do you really bring in so fast adaptability to things? You need to adapt into environments. You have to adapt into business conditions. You need to adapt into the consumer behavior, how the consumer has shifted or changing or what is he expecting. The second piece is equally important is really about people around you, right? How you really deal with them. That's another very big challenge, you know. And especially these days, it's even bigger challenge. You know, you don't know who you're really picking up phone and calling and with sudden amount of expectation and you have somebody not doing well or something happened in the family and things like that. So everything is changing in this period. So how do you really build different skills of living in this harmony of this mess going around? And how do you really adjust yourself to your people skills? Very, very important. It's just not about effectively communicating, right? This has gone beyond that now. So you need to really have, a fair understanding and real-time understanding of what is happening around your people, which is important. Third point is, which is very important for leader to really understand and appreciate is self-awareness. How aware you are about your organization and you yourself. And how receptive you are for the things you need to improve yourself and your organization. And people who are self-aware and they know their gaps, one, they would find somebody to fill that gap. That's very important because otherwise, or you would skill up yourself to fill that. So it's very, very important to ask tough questions to yourself. As a leader, you need to really be very, very clear and ask yourself tough questions that why are you doing this and why did this happen and so on and so forth. The fourth point, which is equally important, is keeping the eye on why we started all this. What is the sense of purpose, right? Why we started everything, was there is a larger reason to it. And what was that reason? And sometimes when you are building up an enterprise, building up a business, you start forgetting that piece itself. You know, it becomes something different, right? And you're just trying to then run the maths of the business and try to keep it float and so on and so forth. So how do you really revisit it back and start to see, think through and say, what is your sense of purpose? Why are you really at the first stage started this? And is this still aligned with the purpose, or the purpose has moved the goal? And that's something which is very, very important. And I've seen businesses which were started with a different purpose and have now reached to a different objective. And then you're trying to drive something else, you know. So this is very important for you to really understand that you keep your purpose alive and keep reminding you yourself, and then also to your enterprise or your company, that we have this common purpose. And it also has to be bought by your team, because if they don't buy into your purpose, larger purpose, and they also share that purpose with you, it would not work. And again, this is another big gap which I see in mid-sized companies or small companies, because sometimes the business owner is definitely having a purpose, but is not aligned with his organization. There is no buying into the larger purpose which he started. A lot of other companies, I'm seeing that changing. I'm advising a great entrepreneur who's out of Ahmedabad, IAS officer, left his job. As an IAS, leaving job is a big, big task, started an FMCG company. And I was talking to him, he has built some kind of patented products and taking it to everywhere. And as he gets to his comfort zone, where his product is already doing well, he's already in supermarkets, he has started withdrawing that because he wants to now go into creating his own brand equity, and he doesn't want other resellers to sell it. He wants to create his own challenge. And also, there are many people who are coming to him and want to buy his patented product. He doesn't want to sell because he says, I never came into this business for just to make money or something like that. And if that was the reason, I was much comfortable in my IAS position. My purpose was to really be somebody who's an innovator, who's able to bring in something to this world and challenge what has been going on and why we are not changing things which we've been doing that, and why don't I challenge even the multinationals who try to come and sell us a product, but why can't we as an Indian can create a superior or a better product than them? So a lot of these things are running in his purpose, you know. So if you really see, he's coming from that and he continues to drive that value chain in his company. Another area which is very important is how decisive you are in these times. Making good judgments in these times are very, very important, because at this stage, unless and until you are somebody who can decide, while you have to decide very fast, but it should come with a little bit of validation. It should come with the intelligence which you feed yourself. So I like entrepreneurs who are opinions on that, right? So sometimes they're very opinions driven. So we put our own experience, our own opinions on things, but that doesn't work. If you really want to, you need to distance yourself from enterprise and take all the data coming to you, and data should reflect the judgments you make on that. And then also there is sometimes chances that your judgment was not right, or the decision you took was not appropriate at that time, but it's still data driven, right? So it's still very, very data driven rather than something which is your impulsiveness or your experience which comes in. Finally, the last part is how do you build your collaborative skills? One of the qualities of a leader is that he's connecting the dots, right? So how do you connect and make everybody collaborate? But you are the one who's connecting the dots. And how do you do that? How do you really build that piece is equally and very, very important. So this was about leadership, and this is what about today's session. We do this short 30-minute session, 25-minute of my presenting on a topic, and then a few questions if Sonali has. I will be happy to take that questions. And so Sonali, over to you if you have any questions for me.
Thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for another very practical and very insightful session on effective leadership for business excellence. We do have quite a few questions lined up with us, so I would just like to take up the first one. The first question is from Mr. Rajat Malik. He says, very good point on realistic optimism, but how to actually achieve it? It's hard to stay positive during this time, but at the same time, it's hard not to get carried away.
Yeah, very good, Rajat. I think, it's every day you will have, rather in a particular day, you will have a lot of highs and lows. It was earlier situation was that we used to do this a good month and a bad month. Now I say good hour or a bad hour. You know, so this hour was good for you and the next hour is not so good for you because you got a message for somebody or somebody called you for something and things like that. And higher the leadership position you are in, I can tell you this would shift into minutes how you're dating. But you need to keep the eye on very realistic optimism. You need to be optimistic. We have to be. This is a life altogether, and we have to be. Why I say realistic? Because you need to really make some realistic short goals and try to achieve that. And like in the morning, I was doing a review with my team and giving a message on what should be May. And it was, I want to be honest. I didn't want to go back and say, this is the month we will do this and we want to do that. And it was wrong for me to say that. And that's why I said, May is going to be very tough. So at least we are clear about it. So we are clear about it that May is going to be very tough. And then I said, okay, but there are goals we can achieve. Sitting at our homes, there are goals which we can achieve. Can we take smaller goals and make smaller increments every single day on that? And that looked easy. You know, if I go in the same manner I used to do and say on first morning and say 20% extra of your last month's target is now your target. That's not going to work. It's not that time. You know, you have to be realistic and set some goals which can be realistic. You know, it's like somebody who I was reading a book which says, minimum habits or minimum something like that. And it says that if somebody wants to really do 50 sit-ups, and if I tell somebody who's never done sit-ups and say you have to do 50, not going to do it. It's not going to work. But if I go and somebody says, at least you can do one to start with, then they want to say, one is easy. One I can do. But nobody actually does one. They would do more. And then they would do more. And that's how it would start moving in. So this is a time of putting realistic, smaller expectations and keep moving upward of that.
Absolutely, sir. The next question I would like to take up is there any specific parameter to evaluate employees? What is the evaluation method you suggest?
Again, very, it's very difficult and to answer because every employee has a different KPI, KRA to measure their performance, it's easier for people who are, you know, more manner driven to measure that. But when it comes to organizations, revenue generating teams, which are the most in challenge these days, it becomes even more difficult. So you need to really set some own guidelines and to really see how you're going to be measuring that. And I think setting accountability, which is daily performance, is very important. Some people don't agree with me. A lot of my own employees don't agree with me. They don't like and say, how can you can bring things to daily accountability? But that's something which every organization has to do. And that's how, if you really see all these companies talk about the best companies of the world, which are the Googles and the Microsofts and the Apples and likes of them, because they are technology companies, they might be from an outside looks like a great working environment, but they're keeping tap on people's man hours. So you might be sitting and working in Google in some remote place and you think that, I'm working in Google and gives me work from home for 1 year and everything. But Google is keeping a tap on every hour what you're doing. So because it's created an accountability from an hour to hour performances, how many hours you were logged in, how much you were coding. So everything is very accountable. So they don't really care where you are. Because they are setting the accountability, which is on nothing. Now, problem happens with smaller businesses because they don't have that ability to do it. And they get frustrated. They're only linked with the results, but then have no productivity alignment coming in on a daily basis. So one thing which I think one should do is bring in shorter accountabilities and also rewarding in the same manner. Everyday win, everyday success, everyday celebration. That's kind of a approach one has to do.
Right. The next question I would like to take up is, I've often heard you say that make your business work without you, but how to really achieve that? It's hard to think that my business might function without me and makes me feel insecure. Any suggestions here?
Yeah, so this is something which is very important. If you are the only person who has to do everything and the business revolves around you, then business is great. It might be great, but it is not, to me, valuable. You'll not be able to transfer that business to anybody else because you are the most integral part of it. But if you are able to shift that business and move you out of it and yourself, and system and process can run that business or create and carve out a leadership team, you know, which can really run without you, then the business becomes more valuable. Now, this is something which I have done and I have not done both. In one business of mine, which is franchising and what I'm doing now, I don't want to be out of it. So I don't want to replace myself and put this entire thing because I'm a little bit of a too involved in this business. And this is my life, which I want to do. It's like a routine for me. If I don't do this, I don't have anything to do. But in some other businesses where I want to really build value, I've done it successfully. I'm not involved myself in any form. I gave the direction. I'm involved in the strategic way. But I remove myself from there and the business can run by itself. So I know they're more valuable, those businesses, than sometimes what I'm driving myself. And if anybody looks at, there was a company which was looking and coming to me and said, we want to look at a big, one of my companies they wanted to acquire. And they said, one thing is that it's all about you. Everything is about you. And if you're not there, that this business would not have value. And I learned it. And it was right. And I told my younger brother and says, it makes sense. If both of us are not in this business, then half of the business is gone, you know? And so it's very, very important that how do you really, if you are consciously building value for your enterprise, we should do. I encourage every business owner to consciously work towards making yourself redundant in your own business. And it is tough, but once you do that, you know more needed in the business, your business is great value.
Absolutely. One question that we have is, can you please repeat the three I's that you mentioned for a leader?
So three I's are initiative, interpreter, and intelligence. Three I's for that, how you are the one who takes the initiative, how you interpret things, and how you bring collective intelligence. I said, use the word collective intelligence. It's not just your intelligence, but you bring in collective intelligence for you. These three are the only leadership. Rest, everything written, so much written on leadership, actually really speaking, makes no sense to me sometimes. You know, these are, general leadership skills, which everybody would have. But these three are very, very important. You need to be somebody who takes the first initiative. You are a great interpreter of things. And third, you bring in collective intelligence. And these three are the most biggest quality. You might be political, you might be business, you might be a sports leader, but you always would have these three things with you.
Right. So quickly, the next question that I would like to take up is how to stay positive and not get discouraged by the advancements by competition.
Actually, sometimes it's a positiveness itself that your competition is advancing. So it tells you a couple of things. One, your industry and the category has a lot of opportunity to grow. You know, disappointment would be that if you feel that your industry and category is degrowing, right? So then what are you going to do, you know? But if you think that your competition is going very fast, then one thing is now clear that your industry has enough and more opportunity to really capture. The only thing is that you have a missing point. Now, some people try to be what I call the great number two. Some find a new path, staying honest to the industry, but find their own disruption to come and lead. So you need to really see where you are at this stage and what path you want to take in both sense structure. So like Apple took a disruption path. To beat Nokia, they didn't follow, but Samsung took the follow path. they were following what Nokia was doing, and Apple came, disruption. They said, no, we don't want to do, and we don't want to even look at what they produce, because if we look at, we will create a copy or better copy of that, right? So you want to create something new. So that's where they went. And Samsung shifted, being second to Nokia, and they became second to that because they just follow the leader. So that's, both are satisfying. Both are satisfying. Not that you have to be an Apple or a Samsung, but both are great organizations to me. And both have a different approach to the way they do business, right? One is very disruptive, innovator thinking. Second is following the trend or following the leader, but doing it more, doing it better. So that's what, and both are right in sense. I mean, and most of the businesses would choose these two paths.
Right, sir. Another question that I would like to take up is, you said the founders have the fear of delegating because they have trust issues. But what about this? As a founder, many have trusted and their trust has been broken time and again. How do you think a founder can be optimistic about trusting someone again and delegating tasks?
Question is, and when you trust, you know, that's the question. You don't have a choice not to trust, but when you trust is a question, and how far you trust. That's also a question. So you need to really, so everything comes with some kind of, checkpoints. That's very, very important. You know, I remember when one of the CEOs, which Narayan Murthy handpicked and gave the ability to run becoming a CEO for entire thing, and he himself built a discomfort with him after 1 year and a half year. And he actually had to push him out of the business and selected somebody else. So he gave the full freedom, but he also didn't mean that you can run the way you want to run it, right? So there is a certain value system. So you have to trust, and when you want to trust, that's important. And how far you want to trust, that's also very important. But it's not from a negative question viewpoint. You can, not doubting, but you very disciplined on certain amount of checkpoints, as I would say.
Another question we have is, as a leader, do we balance the creditors and debtors? We need to ensure the show goes on. Problems are at both the ends. So how do we balance the same?
Yeah, that's again so creditors and debtors are if you break the equilibrium, is very difficult. Sometimes answers are coming, sit over cash, hold, not pay off, keep the cash, right? That also is wrong, because you need to keep the continuity of your business, which also involves around a lot of other people around you and things around your vendors, your suppliers. If you break that, and I've seen that, people breaking that. I've seen big retailers. Earlier, they were running on 2-month credit, and they pushed that to 4 months and actually killed a lot of suppliers and eventually killed them. You know, this started happening with Future Group in 2019. They took the credit lines to 6 months. And as the COVID happened, because they were running on a 6-month cycles and 5-month cycles, their suppliers withdrew. And that's why it surprises you with the category like FMCG, which everybody started rising, FMCG, and Future Group declined. And everybody else, even your local Kiriana, was doing very well. Why? Because they were not getting credit marked. Because they were already done that even before COVID, and everybody got scared and said, look, if we increase more credit line with them right now, it might be an issue. So they had an issue. And this is what is really from the industry. And so you need to really keep the balance doing it. And you're right, you need to do, but you need to also be having sufficient fuel in your own tank to survive. That's also very important.
Absolutely, sir. And the final question that I would like to take up is, how to overcome fear psychology amongst team members?
Again, this is something a work in progress for me and everybody else also in the market. It's at this stage, this is a difficult question to answer. and not any questions I would say I have answers on, you know, and this is one of the questions I don't have answer on, because it is a fear environment, and you need to only teach them how to live with that fear. Removing that is very difficult. There's no pep talks required, you know, there's no nothing required at this moment. People have their own understanding and their own resilience to come from their own perspective. And I think a lot of them are shining. And we are seeing around, and I see these young doctors who are working in these hospitals and working out. And I know when every evening they would go, you know, back to home, their parents would say, there is no need to do this, what you're doing. They still go back to work. Not that they can withdraw. They want to withdraw, they can withdraw. But it is because they're finding their own resources. I don't think any pep talk would ever work for them. So it's a call for duty, call for their own works, for their self pride, for their self work structure would really rise at this moment.
Absolutely, sir. And with this, we'll just wrap up our Q&A session. Thank you so much for very patiently answering all the questions that we had, as always. And anything you would like to say in the end, sir?
Thank you very much. Thanks for joining in. And keep the focus. And out of this whole 30 minutes, if you feel that any one thought you liked, which can help you, just write it down. We get so much out there. But if we are able to put one good thought every day and it adds up into your own learning curve, that's good enough. So if you get one good thought out of this, just write it down somewhere and add it to your learning curve, you know. So we all learn from each other. So thank you very much. Thanks for coming in. And if you have any work interest on business tax, which helps you to raise capital, helps you to value or exit, or even any other feedback you have, please reach out to us. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful session as always. And thank you to our attendees. We really hope we were able to add value to your lives through this session. And we'll see you next time, next Saturday at 11 a.m. with another session on the series of BX Academy Business Excellence Mentoring and Coaching. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.